Good afternoon.
I would like to call this meeting of the Oldham County Board of Education to order. We are at Oldham County Schools Arts Center, and it is August 22nd, 2016. And the first item of business will be to approve the agenda. Corrections or additions, Mr. Schultz?
Besides that one date I shared with you beforehand, everything else should be there.
All right, there is a correction for a date on consent agenda item J. The date says 2016, August 30th, and it should be read August 30th, 2017. You can make that correction. So with that minor correction, may I have a motion to approve the agenda, please? Motion made by Mr. Dodson, seconded by Ms. Beckner. All those in favor? And that's 5-0. Thank you all. And welcome, everybody. Nice to see you all here for our instructional session. Before we begin, I would like to introduce Dr. John Millay, who is our superintendent's mentor. So behave yourselves, okay? Thank you for being here. Let's begin, Superintendent, and we will go straight to our instructional session.
Okay, there's one thing you can guarantee in life. Well, a couple things: taxes, death, and then changes in the accountability system. And so once again, Ms. Robertson is going to present to you the changes in the accountability system that will affect this year and next year.
Welcome, Ms. Robertson.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. You have in front of you a PowerPoint printout so that you can follow along with me. Please forgive us if a couple of these slides look a little distorted. We're having a little bit of technical difficulty, but it will follow along exactly like you see in hard print. So hopefully that won't change the way that you're looking at the particular model. As Mr. Schultz said, we are looking and embarking on a brand new accountability model, which is not something new to this board. You've seen several just in your tenure probably, but I want to highlight the changes, and so you can also see some of the things that you're going to be able to expect as we have the rollout of 15-16 scores. We're going to be using at the end some examples from 14-15 data for you. So basically what that looks like is the state, when they designed this new model, wanted to let folks know basically how you would have fared under your 14-15 scores had you had this new model. And so at the conclusion, we'll hand those out to you, and you'll be able to bring those with you, and you'll be able to see how that affected particular schools. The focus of this presentation is going to be making sure, to the best of our ability in the next 35 minutes, that you can understand the model so that when we get the new scores, all of that won't be a surprise to you. We're going to go ahead and get started. I will veer away a little bit from the microphone, but I'll try to put my teacher voice on because there's some things I will need to be able to point out to you. So the main reason why we're here is the changes that you're going to be seeing as we go through this model. Know as we start that the biggest change you're going to notice is that the focus is now moved strictly to a continuous improvement model. While there is still an achievement piece to it, the high focus and weight is on continuous improvement for all schools. So you'll be able to see that they're changing more from this idea of assessment as a judgment to assessment as finding ways to improve, which of course is why we assess. And so you'll see components of that as we move through here. To begin with, you're already familiar with the five big components of our current accountability model, and those are graduation rate, college career readiness, and then for elementary and middle only, growth, gap, and achievement. Those are going to stay intact, but they're going to evolve a little bit. And of course, we also have a program review piece that I'll show you in just a second. How they're evolving is we're going to see changes in the growth and the gap model. And so where we typically only looked at student growth percentiles and growth, we now have come to a two model system where we're going to be looking at what we call categorical growth, and we're going to keep those student percentiles. In GAP, we're moving strictly from just having a one system model of non-duplicated GAP to a two model system where now we're also focused on novice reduction. What I really want you to see is it's not that we're adding new things, it's that we're looking at things differently and weighting things differently. So I don't want you to think, even though it's a new model, that all of these concepts are new to us. They are things that we've been familiar with, but now the lens is sort of really staring at certain points of it, and they're going to enhance those by the weight that those will carry. So as we think about that, the first thing I want us to think about are two big scores. And the first score I want you to think about is the overall score, because you're going to see that scores are reported in two or three different ways. The overall score is what's going to determine whether or not a school is classified as needs improvement, proficient, or distinguished, whether or not they get those rewards like schools of distinction, or they get those consequences like focus schools. The next generation learner score is what's going to determine whether or not a school has made AMO. And if you remember, when we talk about AMO, each school has a goal set for them or an objective set for them based on their previous year's scores. So if you were a proficient or distinguished school, you had to make a half a point gain from the previous year's overall score. Or in that case, overall, we're changing that a little bit. If you are needs improvement, you had to make a full point gain. In the past, we've had that based on your overall score, which also included program review. One of the changes from the state is now whether or not you make AMO is strictly determined by how you did on your next generation learner score. So that's the academic piece. Okay, so there's our first big change. So here's a good example that you might think about. If we looked at this example, we can see that this school's prior year score was an 83.2, their target was an 81.6, and their new overall score is an 82.7. I would tell you that this particular school did not make AMO. And a lot of folks would look at that and say, I don't understand how their overall score is higher than their target. That's because the overall score included program review. We're solely looking at next generation learner goals now and scores for AMO. And so you can see that the next generation learner score was not high enough to meet the target. So this school, while they may even have improved, would still not have made AMO strictly because their next generation learner score didn't make the gains it needed to. And you're going to probably see some schools who fall into that category. So don't be surprised. Lots of folks will think that that's a typo or that the state's made a mistake and meant to put yes. But it is because that system has changed a little bit. So as we think about that, and it's moving right along, we'll go to the next one. The next thing you're going to notice, and this is one of those where the screen's a little bit distorted, but hopefully your handout will help you, is we went from our old model where each of those components were weighted differently at each level. For example, at the elementary level, gap and achievement were both weighted at 30 and growth was weighted at 40. Mm-hmm. At middle school, we had 28% at gap, achievement, and growth, and then we had 16% at what we called college ready, which were our explore scores. And then at the high school, all five of those components were weighted at 20% apiece. We've got a few changes to that under our new model. And so the first thing you're going to notice is that the elementary weights have changed. And that really was in response to a lot of feedback from across the state that said the growth component was too high. Initially, when this model was implemented, it made sense that you get the majority of your bang for your buck at growth at the elementary level, so they weighted it that way. But so what they've basically done is redistributed that so that achievement, gap, and growth all carry the same weight for a school. Just when you, if all we did was change the weights, you would see a change in people's scores. So the same scores under no model are going to look different than they would under the new model. When we look at middle school, we also see that they changed those weights for achievement, gap, and growth and made those more in line with what the elementary was looking at. But you'll also notice that in green, you're going to see a little green X, and that should be falling down there pointing to that little green X. The green X represents that temporarily the college readiness will not be reported. Because Explore has gone away and we don't have a replacement yet as a state, they've redistributed those weights in those other three categories, but we do look for that to come back, so it is temporary. At the high school, you're going to notice there are no changes in weights. They are still 20% in every one of the five components. So our first big change was next generation learners determines AMO. Our second big change was the change in weights for two out of the three levels. So we're going to start by looking at achievement first. The only real achievement difference that we're going to see under this new model is that of the language arts content area at the high school. Previously, we took those language scores from the plan, the sub-component of plan for language and usage and mechanics. We have now changed that because plan has gone away. And so they're going to take that same component, but instead of taking it from plan, they're going to take it from ACT. So instead of the language scores coming from sophomores, the language scores at the high school will now come from juniors. That's the only real change in achievement outside of the change in weights for elementary and middle. Okay. So for elementary, it went from 30% weight to 33.3, and for middle, it went from 28 to 33.3. So that's the big changes to achievement. We don't look to see huge shifts in achievement scores based on these for most schools. And indeed, our 14-15 data show that we didn't see a lot of change in those scores, with the exception of a little bit at the high school level. So let's spend just a minute looking at the achievement model and seeing what goes into that particular component and then how we calculate it. The first thing you're going to notice is that we are scored just the same way as we always have. You get 1 point for every percent of your students who are proficient or distinguished, a half a point for apprentice students, 0 points for novice students, and then we have this thing called bonus. And what that basically means is if you have a higher percentage of distinguished than you do novice, you can get a half a point gain for that offset. You're not penalized if you have less distinguished than novice, but you don't get the bonus. So that's what that bar graph is representing for you. You're going to also remember that we have a change in weight for achievement for elementary and middle, and that you also need to understand in achievement that each content area is weighted a little bit differently. Reading, math, social studies, for example, at elementary and middle are all weighted at 25%, writing at 20%, and language at 5%. When we look at high school, it's 20% at all the content areas, with the exception of writing and language, which together make up 20%. One of the things you're going to notice is that science isn't listed with elementary and middle because we are still not using science as a part of our accountability model. That's coming, but it's not yet part of that. However, it is a part of the high school model, so you will see it broken down there for them. As we think about how to score the achievement, there's a lot that goes on there, and so I'm going to stand up here and kind of walk you through this so that it makes a little bit more sense to you. Basically, I'm going to use an elementary middle example, and you would know that because there is no science here. But when a school gets an achievement score, okay, we calculate first what their score would be in each of those components, and then those are weighted accordingly. So if we remember what I had just said, novice, and in this school they would have 15% novice. There are no points for novice, so that the total points would be zero. Apprentice is 0.5%. So if we had 26% of the students scoring at apprentice, we would get a 0.5 point for each of those, and so you can see 13 points came. So basically all you're doing is calculating across each one of those performance levels what the point value would be and coming up with a total point for that subject area. So in reading, they would have had a 74. In math, the school would have had a 60. I want you to pay close attention to the bonus, because I call the bonus a game changer. Oftentimes when we see a school that takes a significant dive, that's the first place I'll look. Because if they've gotten a bonus in the past and they've lost that bonus, they actually got hit twice. They got hit with the 0.5 point from the bonus points, but they also would have gotten hit from the novice moving to apprentice at a 0.5 point. So it can be just a little shift in distinguished. If they were close to having the same number as distinguished and novice, it can be a real game changer for schools. But you can see here, in this instance of math, they had 19% distinguished, but 24% novice. So that's a negative adjustment, so they got zero bonus points. Okay, and again, this is dummy data. Don't be alarmed. Dummy data. So basically, after we calculate what each one of the content areas would be for elementary and middle in this example, we then weight those according to how much each content area weighs. So, for example, if reading was 74 points and it's weighted at 25%, they got 18.5 points out of reading. So we go all the way across and we add up those new weighted points and we get a total next generation learner score in points just for the area of achievement. Remember, that's just one of those circles. Okay? And then we know, as we just talked about, how the weights have changed. Now the achievement is not worth 30% anymore at elementary, or 28% anymore at middle. It's now worth 33.3%. So I'm going to take that score, I'm going to multiply by that weight, and this is my new achievement score, 23.3. It's a lot. It's a lot of math. It's easy to calculate, but there's a lot of math to it. Are there any questions on this particular piece?
I would just like to add a clarifying point, and for the principals back there, they don't have to calculate this, and Leslie doesn't have to calculate this. Luckily, the state calculates it, but the important piece is knowing where those numbers are coming from so that you're focused on the right things.
Leslie, I was busy trying to read this micro print down here on my handout, and so when you moved from those scores at the bottom to explain the next gen achievement points, would you run through that one more time for me, please?
Sure. Each one of these content areas yielded a score, 74 for reading, 60 for math. Those are down here.
Right.
And what we basically did was weight each one of those according to the weight the state gives them.
Correct.
And we add those final points together, we get the achievement points. To get the actual score conversion, we have to multiply those points times the weight that achievement carries for that level. In this example, it carries 33.3% in weight. So their final score will be 23.3.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Thank you.
So again, you can see there's not a lot of difference. There's not much of a learning curve for us. A lot of our schools were almost maxed out in the achievement points as it was. 30 is as high as you can get. And so even with it increasing to 33.3, for most of our schools, that would be a benefit if things stay the way that they typically have been in the past. So we're going to go to the hard stuff now.
Great.
Yeah, the easiest one. It really was. So when we think about the next one, we're going to talk a little bit about this area of gap. What's new is we went from a one model system to a new model system. And this new model system has two components instead of one. For elementary and middle, we also increased the weight of what gap would carry. So just like with achievement, it's going to carry more weight. What we're going to look at now are the differences between the one model system and the two model system. If we look at the first model, the first component, and was solely what our old model was about, was what we called non-duplicated gap. You'll probably remember that. And we remember that our gap group are Hispanics, EL students, students of poverty, special education students, African American students, Native Americans, though we don't typically have that much of a population of those to count. But they made up what we call the non-duplicated gap group. And they call them the gap group specifically because nationally they are underperforming populations of people. And so we have to really focus, if you remember way back when No Child Left Behind was first enacted, we have to focus on making sure that those students in those underperforming subpopulations are being successful in our system. So in the past, we got 1 point for every percentage of students who were proficient or distinguished. And it was 100% of our gap score. Our new model is now broken into two components. The non-duplicated gap group that I just explained to you, only now it will no longer carry 100% of the weight, it will only carry 50% of the weight. And then the new component, which is called a novice reduction component. Now, I know you've heard us talk about novice reduction before. So we were talking about that long before it became a part of this accountability model. But now there's teeth in that game. And so while there's a reward or a perk to reducing your novice, there's also a consequence if you do not. So what we're going to be looking at is how these two models sort of marry together and where you can see that it could really be a game changer in how schools are performing under the system that we've traditionally been measuring them with. And so, the first model again, you're familiar with. Now it's only worth 50% of the score. So if the student is not proficient or distinguished and they're in the gap group, they're not going to gain any points for that school. Okay, that's the first component. It's also in the first component measured in all of the content areas. So just when I did that big achievement gap thing, it would look the same for each of those gap groups. They would all have their own page. It looked just like that to see how they did in reading, how they did in math, how they did in social studies and science. That's going to carry 50% of the weight. When we look at novice reduction, it's a whole different way of looking at things. It is about reducing your percentage of novice within gap groups. So not only are you looking at the gap group as a whole reduction, you're looking at individual subpopulations having to reduce their percentage of novice students. Okay, the goal was in the next 5 years to reduce it by 50%, so that's a 10% reduction a year, and that's what they're going to refer to as your novice target. Okay, and it, unlike the first component, is only going to look at reading and math. So one part of the gap looks at all content areas, the second part that's novice reduction only looks at reading and math. And remember, we had a change in weight. So let's look at what those two models look like in terms of calculations. So here's the non-duplicated gap, and just as I told you, we're going to do it just like we did in achievement. And let's pretend this was our Hispanic population in a particular school. We do all of this for our Hispanic population, okay, and we'd get a score. We do all of this if we had enough students, for example, of poverty or special education, and the magic number there is at least 10 in that population in the school, not in the grade level, but in the school. So that model is not new to us. When we look at our second model, however, it's very different, and it's a very complex model. So we're really going to take just a little bit of time here. And I know that's a little bit hard to see, but hopefully you can see it better on your handout. So I'm going to walk up here again to kind of give you an idea of what this looks like. So this is novice reduction, and I really did try to make this as easy as I could. I know it doesn't look like I did. Again, we have to have at least 10 novice. This is different than the non-duplicated gap where we just have to have 10 in general. This has to be 10 novice within a subpopulation. So what a school basically is doing when they set goals about how they're going to reduce the novice in their schools, they first have to know how many they have in those subpopulations. Mm-hmm. And again, as Mr. Schultz said, they're going to report that to us, but we have to kind of know what to do with that in order to set some of those goals. So in this particular example at this school, they had 6 African Americans in the baseline year that were novice, okay? I'm sorry, 6, period. One of them were novice. So they didn't have enough to have a novice target. It doesn't count against them, but it doesn't count for them. They just don't do anything with that other than continue to work with those students. Same thing with Hispanic. They had seven, but only one of the seven was actually novice. So you can see there's nothing here for them. There's no target. When we come all the way down, you can see this school really has three populations that they're going to be looking at. One is the free and reduced lunch group, one is a disabled group, and one is the gap group. And what's really interesting there is this one is a culmination of everything, okay, as long as it's non-duplicated. So basically, they have three targets they have to meet in novice reduction in this particular school's model. So basically, what they're doing is we see that they need to have a 4.2 in reduction in order to make this target. As we go on through the current year, so this is all based on the previous year. When the current year scores come out, they're looking to see how well they met those reductions for those students. So when we look at that, you can see, for example, if we just look at free reduced lunch, in the second year they had 61 students that counted, 20 of them were novice, and so now the school has 33% of their students who are novice. That means they met 100% of their goal, okay, so they're good to go on that one. But if we look what happened with their special needs students, for example, we can see that they went from having, basically in a nutshell, 35% of their students novice to 43%, which means they are definitely not reducing their novice. They're going the wrong direction. They've met 0% of their goal. Okay? And then we see here in the total gap group, they went from 35 to 32. They met. So what's basically happening here is they met, if you think about this, there was 300 possible. They got 200 of the 300. That's where that 66.7 is coming from. They met 2 out of 3, okay? You're going to see schools who end up having zeros all the way down here probably and end up with this entire component having a zero. Doesn't mean they didn't move any kids. It means they didn't necessarily move enough to hit their target. So I don't want you to be shocked if you see that, because you should expect to see that. Okay, you'll see that with 14-15 crosswalk data. Why it's important for us to understand it, and what it's telling us, is every kid counts, obviously, under this model. There is nowhere to hide in this model. Mm-hmm. So you could have a school who did quite well in GAP last year, for example. Okay, they did quite well. Under just non-duplicated GAP, they were doing pretty well. They had a lot of proficient and distinguished and have been making climbs. Those same scores under this new model can look drastically different. They could be cut completely in half if they didn't get any points at all for novice reduction. So don't be shocked if you see either big jumps or big losses here, because that can certainly happen just in the way that the model was organized. Are there any questions with this one? Just the math part that I did? I know it is tricky, and it is a lot of hand math, looking at how those things look. Once we do that for each of those groups in reading and math, we come up with, again, you can see in my example in math, they all had zeros. Right? So in reading, we had a couple of them that met, but in math, none of those subpopulations met novice reduction. So we had our 66.7 from reading and our zero from math, and because those are combined for this 50% score, they're only going to get a 66.7. Then we divide that in half because there are two content areas, and you can see that their score moving forward is a 33.4. Keep in mind, novice reduction is only, again, 50% of the overall GAP score now. So I have to take that number and multiply it by 50% to get my final next generation learner component for just this section of GAP. Hopefully what you're seeing is I'm not trying to confuse you, but that is a very complex system.
Yeah.
And it's new to everybody in this room. And so we're really looking forward to getting those scores and seeing what it will allow us to see. Again, there's no new information in the system. We've always known who novice kids are and who apprentice kids are. We've always known if kids jump from novice to proficient, but we've never had it as a part of our model and looked at it through that lens. So when I get my final GAP score, here's what it's going to look like. From non-duplicated GAP, in the examples I just gave you, they got a 35.1. When I looked at novice reduction, they got considerably lower, a 16.7. So their total GAP score together in points was a 51.8. We know that at elementary middle, it's weighted at 33.3%, so their total GAP score for next generation learner would be a 17.25. Big difference from what their achievement score was, right?
Yes.
All right. It just keeps getting better.
Okay.
Hope so.
Take a breath. I'm hanging on, Leslie.
Okay.
Their faces kind of mirror our faces, though.
Yes. So you are an exciting crowd.
I'm not so alarmed. Thank you, Leslie.
Let's move on to the last big area that changes. It's that area of growth. And it is doing the same thing as GAP is doing. It's moving from a single component area to a two-model system. So when we think about those, I also want you to think about the weights changing. A little bit unlike the other areas where the weights went up for elementary and middle and GAP and achievement, the weight goes down a little bit for elementary here. So it's going down from being worth 40% to now only being worth 33%. Now that's pretty good news for a school who struggled with growth. It's not worth as much. But it's also good, it also can be bad news for somebody who excelled in growth because now it's worth less to them. When we look at middle school, it jumped right up from the 28 to 33.3, just like it did in achievement and GAP. Again, there are no changes at all to growth at the high school level. That's going to be for one more year, okay? So it stays exactly the same. It's apples to apples for sure at high school when we look at growth. In our current model, previous to this new change, we looked at only what we called student growth percentiles. You'll probably remember those. When we talked about if a student met at least above the 40th percentile when compared to their academic peers, the school was credited for that. We only compared kids with how they started. So you're not comparing a novice student to a distinguished student. You're comparing that novice student to other students across the state who scored similar to them to see in percentile ranks how well they grew. So it is a growth model. That was our only model, and 100% of the growth score came from that model. It was also only looked at in the areas of reading and math averaged. So a school could have done really well in reading growth and not so well in math, and it could have looked like they did okay if you don't break those apart because they are averaged. When we look at the new model, it's a 50% model, just like in GAP. The first 50% is just like you know it here, student growth percentiles. At or above the 40th percentile, reading and math, nothing changes. The new model, the new portion of the model that's worth 50% is actually a really good thing, and it's called the categorical growth model, and it also arose from feedback from across the state. If you remember us talking about the novice group and how large the score range is in novice, you can have a student who's working really hard and making a lot of growth who for several years in a row could still be novice because that span of scores is so big. And so schools weren't getting any recognition for the fact that they were moving kids and those kids were growing at high levels. They just weren't growing at high enough levels to get out of novice. So one of the things the state wanted to put in this model was the opportunity to also give you credit if students improved a performance level. So now you are going to get credit for those students who move from a novice to apprentice to proficient, a proficient to distinguished. You also get credit for students who stay proficient or distinguished. And so that's the new component. We'll look at the math on that in just a second. But just know it's a two-part model as well. The first part that we'll look at is the one that you're really familiar with, which is you got 1 point for every percentage of students who are at or above the 40th percentile when compared to their academic peers. The second one is you get 1 point for every percentage of students who increase a performance level or stay at proficient or distinguished. Reading and math are also in this component weighted equally at 50%, and of course we had a change in weight at elementary and middle to remember. When we think about student growth percentiles, just to refresh your memory, you know that this is across 2 years for students. So you would take, for example, a third grader's score in math, whatever they scored on the K-prep in math that year, and they would recalibrate that student's scores with everybody across the state and find a cohort of students who had similar scores as that student. A whole year would pass, instruction would go on, and the next year they would see how that same student scored as a fourth grader. And they would percentile rank all of those new scores as fourth graders to see how much that student grew relative to the folks around them. Okay? So it is absolutely relative to how people perform around you in order to get those kind of percentiles. You as a school got points if your student scored at least that 40th percentile, which is below average. So you got a pretty good shot there if your students are at least growing at a little below average in order to get those points. When we think about how that plays out, you have a percentage of students who made the reading 40th percentile and above, and a percentage of students who had math. And those were combined, and this is where I was talking about how one could really offset the other. You could do really well in one and not so well in another and still look like you're kind of staying the same. So it's important to look at how your students are doing in both of those areas. That model has stayed the same. It's exactly the same. The only change in that model is that now it's only worth 50% of their gross score instead of 100. So if we look at the second component, what we're going to notice is something a little trickier. Not quite as bad as GAAP, but it's still a little tricky. So basically what happens is the state's looking at what percentage of your students improved, which means they improved a performance level, okay, from novice to apprentice, apprentice to proficient, etc. What percent stayed proficient or distinguished, and then what percent did not improve, okay? So when you think about that, you go all the way across and you average the total improvement, not average, you divide the total improvement by the total number of students, you're going to get points for that content area. Those points are then averaged, reading and math together, and you are have been given at that point a categorical growth point score. We know that just like with student growth percentiles, it's only worth 50% of overall growth. So if I look at reading and math, it looks like these particular school, this particular school, they scored pretty much the same way in reading and math. And this is only 50% of my growth score. So what I'm walking away with from categorical growth is 40.8 points. When we look at those at 50%, sorry, that looked weird. I think that came off that other slide. You had 17.5% in student growth percentiles and 40.8 in categorical growth, which was 58.4 growth points. We know those are weighted at 33.3% at the elementary and middle, and it's 20% at the high school to give us the total point value for growth at 19.5. So you can think of it as 19.5 out of 33.3 possible, if that's the way you think about things like that. How close are they to maxing out there? As we think about what those look like all together, we can see that if I take all the points from those three components and I add those points up, this school has a next generation learner score of 60.1. Okay, that's the one, if you recall, that AMO is determined by. If I take their next generation learner score and multiply that times 77%, and then whatever they got on program review, and multiply that times 23%, and I add those together, I get what's called the overall score. That's the one that determines whether or not I'm proficient, distinguished, or needs improvement. I will tell you most of our schools max out on program review, so they most always get the full 23 points. So really for us, the game changer obviously is the next generation learner score. Okay, we did the three hardest ones, so I want to just stop and let you breathe and see if you have any questions, and then we'll kind of start wrapping this up.
I have a couple. Have you taken this new model and looked at our test scores from last year and see how our schools would fare with this new model, just as a kind of get an estimation? And I was wondering if you could tell us what you found.
We did. Actually, we didn't have to do that math. The state provided that for us, and what they called that was a 14-15 crosswalk. So basically what they did was take the 14-15 scores that were rolled out according to our normal model last year, and they put those exact same student scores in the new model. Mm-hmm. Do you want to speak to that?
I was going to say, you have a handout that you will, or if you don't have it now, you'll get it as Leslie finishes. I didn't want to focus a whole lot on that because I'm afraid that's a little bit of dead data. It's tied to last year's scores, and I didn't want to get everybody riled up, but we do want to definitely show you that so you have a point of comparison. These numbers will be on the school report card this year. Those numbers that were achieved last year are locked forever. Whatever the school scored, whatever their percentiles were, whatever their classifications were, are locked in. But because the state is always trying to compare apples and apples, and they do these reconfigured, they do that. And so when the new report cards come out, you'll have this as your kind of your baseline score compared with this.
Thank you. So we do have the hand to you as we go through. But yes, that is certainly one of the things we wanted to see, as again how our schools were able to fare under this new system and where we needed to do our continuous work and looking at areas to get better.
Leslie, I think, yes, ma'am. Did you have another question, Mrs.
I'm
Beckner?
Sorry, I know you've probably explained this before, and this is just for my out of curiosity. When you have the non-duplicated data, and if you would have a student that was disabled, a minority, and receive free and reduced lunch, how do they determine which group to place that data in?
For the non-duplicated GAAP side, remember there's two models now, or a two-component model. For the non-duplicated GAAP 50%, they just count once. So whether they're just one of those, one of those demographics, or they're in all of them, they still, their scores only count once. When you look at novice reduction, however, they're going to fall into as many categories as they actually are in. So there is some duplication there. It's no longer non-duplicated gap. They're going to fall into whatever categories, if you remember that one table where they show up. If they happen to be novice. If they're not novice, they're not represented in that data at all.
Yeah.
So that's a great question.
Yeah, thank you, Jennifer.
It is a little bit of a shift there.
Thank you, Leslie.
Okay, I promise we're getting, you're now to the easy stuff, we're on the home stretch. So as we think about this next component, it was obviously high school only, and it was the graduation component, and the only thing that has changed there are how the targets are met, and a little bit with some early graduation. But when we say targets met, if you recall, for example, North Oldham High School oftentimes had scores that would qualify them as a school of distinction in the past, but because they didn't make their graduation rate goal, even though it was they had a great graduation rate, they were never able to be a school of distinction under that model. And that was because the state was using very old baselines at that time. And unfortunately for North Oldham, they did very well right out of the gate. So you could never drop, not even a tenth of a point, and be able to make graduation goal, or graduation rate. Under this new system where those targets have been reset, they will do much better under that. They're a lot more reasonable for them. So no big changes other than to our schools who have very high graduation rates comparatively, and I know continue to work on that, but hopefully they'll get some of the rewards out of that if they haven't in the past. And that's really the only big change you have there. We also didn't get credit for early graduates if they graduated before the 100-day accountability mark, and now we do. So even if they haven't been there 100 days, if they graduate, we get to get credit for them as a graduate. So that's the two big things that are going on with graduation. If we think about college and career readiness, really the only big change we have is, again, that temporary removal of college readiness because of the Explore scores at middle school. The state still says that they are looking to replace that. We don't know if this accountability model will change completely or just that one component. But as of right now, again, the weight that it would have carried has been redistributed to those other three components, gap, achievement, and growth. Big walkaways we want you to think about as we go through here. There are certainly some challenges. Mm-hmm. Our schools, I know, when they saw their data and were able to see how much these changes in the components, even though the student scores are the same, mm-hmm. how the changes in components can really cause their scores to fluctuate, those are something we're going to have to obviously be very responsive to. And that's going to take some learning, but it's also going to reinforce the work we're already doing, which is making sure we're meeting the needs of every one of our students. This just shines a little bit brighter light on it than it has in the past. There really is nothing new to the work other than to make sure we understand how those scores are reflected. So know that you may see schools who perform very well under our old model who aren't doing quite as well under this new one. And you'll see, you know, on the flip side of that, some schools who have really struggled who do quite well under this model. There is not an advantage for either. They are equal. You don't have more of an advantage under the system as a lower performing school or a higher performing school. It is an even weight, but it is certainly a different way of looking at it. When we think about positives, you're going to see, like I say, some great things happening with a lot of schools who have really put a lot of eggs in this basket and doing a lot of this work. And those efforts are now going to be recognized in this model, whereas they weren't necessarily recognized in our previous model. So you're going to see some exciting things and some things that make you sort of raise your eyebrows probably. But know at the end of the day, for us, it is about looking at this system changing from a system of judgment where we just say, hey, this is where they are and this one's better than that one, to really saying, hey, this school needs to work on this and this one's extremely good at this, but they need to work on that. And what you're going to see is no matter how high performing schools have been in the past and continue to be, they all have areas that they're going to have to really focus on and work on. You'll no longer be able to compare, for example, a Goshen and a Harmony, because they're going to look very different under this model, depending on what their unique situations are within their schools. So that's our challenge as a district leadership team and as building leaders, is to say, okay, now it really is about looking at just exactly what's going on in the school and seeing where we can make those improvements. Those will inform their new goals that you'll probably see at the school level in their CSIPs, and also I'm sure in our district goals as we move forward. But at the end of the day, lots of promising information coming out of this data and lots of great improvements. And sometimes you just have to rip that Band-Aid off a little bit to see them. But we are excited about all the new information that we're able to see about our students.
Mm-hmm.
So just at this point, again, just kind of closing questions you may have or comments.
Questions or comments, board members? Point of clarification, Leslie, our schools have received their individual data.
Yes, ma'am.
And are in the process, I'm assuming, of digesting it and examining it. I think you know, you have been preparing us for some of these changes, so I know that we all appreciate this, going over this information again. And I think this will also lead to some more interesting discussions at our site-based council visits. Also, we will want to talk to you now about those individual students who we can now identify. Other questions or comments?
I'd just like to thank Leslie. I mean, I've seen this presentation done at the state level, done in different districts, very clear. And I know if you've never seen this before, you're saying, that's very clear. I've seen it a lot. That's very clear. She's done a nice job breaking it down in understandable language. The biggest takeaway for all principals is obviously, and Leslie hit it on the head, it's individual student. We've talked about that for a couple of months just in my rolling into the district, is that the big data looks really positive. We have to look at the individual student data if we're going to move ourselves forward. And really, you know, Mr. Shum mentioned earlier, you know, closing the gap. It's those exact type of things that we need to focus on.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yes, thank you very much, Leslie.
Thank you. And I'll give
thank you,
this
you very much.
You.
All right. Thank you, Leslie.
And after Leslie passes out that information, you probably won't have a time to digest it now, but if you do and you have any questions, please contact Leslie or myself or Amy, and we'll be more than glad to answer any questions you have.
Absolutely. Thank you. Let's move forward with our agenda then, board members, and we are ready for the treasurer's report, Mr. Davis. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Mine probably won't be as interesting as Leslie's, but beginning on page 4 is the treasurer's report. We begin with the cash balances. I've put this in a little bit different format from the previous months, just to thought we needed to update that. We have two types of funds, governmental funds and proprietary funds. And so what I've done is grouped them together in governmental funds, that's how much we have there, and then in proprietary funds, food service and daycare, I have those separated. And then on pages 5, 6, and 7 is the detail of those, gives a little bit more information on those accounts. But I thought that would give you, just tells you a little bit as to how the proprietary funds are doing in their cash balances at the end of the month. And the balances that we had, there's no unexpected variances from what we thought they should be based on the transactions. So on pages 5, 6, and 7, basically on page 5 is a detail of the governmental funds. Shows the beginning of the month balance and our receipts and disbursements, and gives a breakdown of what makes up our governmental funds. And you see general fund, you list them all down through there, and we have $32 million at that point in time. Mm-hmm. And these, of course, are reconciled balances back to the bank statement. If there's no questions on that, I would like to move you to page 9, which is the bonding capacity. Not that anything's changed on here, but I did want to highlight a couple of items related to our bonding. The bonding capacity we have here on page 9, there's been no changes since last month, but based on an email that I got from Dwight last week, our bonds have been sold. The next generation high school bonds have been sold, so this will change once that's finalized and we get the final documents on that. They were sold at 2.671% interest rate. Not only that, our refunding issue, which he had told you previously, and you may know, we had said it would be about a $2.8 million savings over the period of the next 12 years. That savings is now $5,083,000.
Wow.
Now, that will all be inside the building fund due to the reduction in the debt service. But the average interest rate on those bonds prior to refunding was 4.6, and now they're at 1.9. So it's a big difference over $25 million worth of bonds. It's quite a bit of money. So I did want to bring that to your attention, that our even though we issued new bonds, the reduction in our bonding capacity shouldn't be quite as much as what we thought, because we're saving money on the other side related to the refunding debt service. So I did want to bring that to your attention there. And one thing I did not do this month, and probably not next month, is the the comparison of the budget versus actual, because we really don't have a final budget yet, and the money, we haven't had any collections other than basically SEEK and a few small things. So those things will not really be meaningful until September, October, so I will start that again at that point in time.
Correct. Thank you.
That is, and then, of course, the balance sheet and income statement, they start on page 10 and run through page 70, if you have any questions on those.
Are there questions, board members?
Oh, one other thing.
Yes, sir.
Sorry. Before the meeting, we are required to publish a unaudited financial statement in the Old Mayor, which previously we were required to publish, but due to a line item in the budget, the governor was allowing that to be posted to our website. Well, that line was eliminated this year, and we are now required to publish in the Old Mayor. And the financial statement that is to be published is strictly a summary of all your funds together with revenues and salaries and vendor payments and then other. Which, if you look at this, what I gave to you, it doesn't say a thing to me, and I think it's a waste of time, I think it's a waste of money, but we're required to do it. That's my personal opinion. but again, I just wanted to show you what will be in the newspaper. It shows that there is a deficit of $9 million over the operations, but that is due to the construction fund. We had the bonds issued 1 year. We spent the money the next year. Mm-hmm. But if you're looking at this, it really doesn't tell you that. But this is the format that KDE has asked us to put it in. So, and at the same time, this will cost us $1,490 to publish this, plus a vendor statement behind there. So that's monies that we normally did not have to spend in prior years.
$1,400.
So I'm sorry, yeah. I just wanted to bring that
no,
to your
No, I appreciate
attention.
That, Randy, and you had shared this with us, so I am glad that you have now addressed the issue for the public record. Questions or comments on the Treasurer's Report, board members, or this additional report? Motion to approve Treasurer's Report, please. Made by Mr. Shum, seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Bills and claims, please, sir.
Yes, on page 71 begins the bills and claims. We have 1,071 invoices there, totaling $4,880,000. Again, tried to give a little bit of additional information on the pages that follow this summary, just to give you a little bit idea of what they were paid for, in addition to the small amount of characters that we have available to type in. So if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer those for you if I can. If I can't provide the answer tonight, I'll get the answer for you.
Questions, board members, on bills and claims? All right, motion to approve, please. Made by Ms. Beckner and seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Thank you,
Thank
Mr.
You.
Davis. We have two sets of minutes to approve, board members. The first are from the regularly scheduled board meeting on July 25th, 2016. Any corrections or additions to those minutes? Motion to approve, please. Made by Mr. Dodson, seconded by Ms. Beckner. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. The second is from the August 10th, 2016 special called meeting. Corrections or additions? Motion to approve, made by Mr. Woosley and seconded by Mr. Shum. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Superintendent, we are ready for your notice to the Board of Personnel Actions, sir.
In front of you have several pages of personnel actions since we last met. I just ask that you take the report under advisement and direct me if you need me to make any changes.
Certainly. Questions, comments? All right, thank you, Mr. Schultz. We are also ready for the consent agenda, and that is items A through J. Your recommendation, sir?
Please approve the field trips for all, or just are we going individually?
We did
going
the
all.
Whole okay. consent agenda.
Then please approve those consent items as presented.
All right. Motion to approve the consent agenda made by Mr. Dodson, seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. We are now ready to go into executive session, board members. And I am going to look for my insert, and I found it. Thank you, Mr. Woosley. At this time, I found it and I lost it. At this time, I need a motion to go into executive session to discuss the following matters: litigation pertaining to a student injury, litigation pertaining to student disciplinary matters, and the disposal of real estate, the price of which may be affected by public discussion. The board needs to go into executive session pursuant to KRS 61.8101 C and F to meet with the board's attorney regarding litigation preparation and strategy, the public disclosure of which would jeopardize the board's position. Motion to go into executive session made by Ms. Beckner and seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Thank you all.